students, and many thanks for coming. People who just arrived for this public lecture as part of our conference, Mediating Cultural Work. A couple of years ago, Professor Kate Oakley, who is somewhere in this room, there she is, Professor Kate Oakley and I wrote a paper about arts education and cultural policy. As part of the research involved in that, we were searching for previous work on the history of UK art schools, and rather naively we thought this is going to be an abundance of academic literature and popular literature written about art schools. And we were surprised, I think, and probably a bit disappointed to find that this was a topic that not many people had seen fit to write very much about. And surprising, I suppose, given the importance of these institutions to arts education in the 20th century, particularly for ordinary people, and their role, I suppose, in the post-war story of the UK and kind of emerging kind of social democracy. Outside of Simon Frith's book, Art into Pop, outside of Michael Bracewell's kind of rather curious but brilliant book about boxing music, and John Savage's kind of punk history of UK, England's dream, very little had been written that was kind of connecting the experience of being at art school with the kind of political and social significance that art schools have exerted in the UK. So it was great, wonderful, and surprising to come across an article written by Matthew Cornford and John Beck called The Art School in Ruins, written in 2012 in the Journal of Visual Culture. Which for me kind of brilliantly captured both the environmental and the existential experience of being an art school student, I guess, but also really situated the significance of art schools within their social and political time. And what they did was produce a very effective piece of writing, actually, with an A, which I found kind of very moving, because it was written without sentimentality, it was written without nostalgia, it was, to my mind, kind of, it made me think really about what we might mean by a kind of progressive politics of memory. So this kind of complete piece of writing about the British art school was really important to Kate and I in undertaking our work, and part of the reason why I wanted to invite Matthew and John to our conference is to get them to share a little bit about the thinking and the work that went into their writing. But what this article also revealed was an ongoing and unfolding project mapping, photographing the trajectory, the history of the British art school. Some of the work involved in that you can see in the far corner of the room, you'll get a chance to look at later maybe. And Matthew and John are here today to talk about that project and to talk about their wider interest in the UK art school. So I'd like to welcome both Matthew and John.
With a few exceptions, such as the Royal College of Art, art schools were part of the further education sector There were no BA degrees in art awarded until, I think, 1974. Even a cursory survey of education policy in the UK since World War II suggests that there has been no stage or period where a consensus prevailed as to what, how, where, or why students should learn. Art education has always been a low priority for administrators and politicians, and as such it's often been swept up in broader transformations of the education system. The university has always served as a gold standard against which supposedly lesser forms of post-compulsory education have been measured. And adult education has been part of the inexorable move toward the consolidation of a single institutional structure that we more or less see today. The short-lived colleges of advanced technology, which were invented in response to a dismal 1956 white paper on the state of technical education, were 2 years later, just 2 years later, upgraded to university status. The much heralded polytechnics of the mid-1960s, many of which swallowed up nearby art schools, were also aspiring to join the ranks of universities almost as soon as they were founded. There is already evidence, a report in New Scientist announced in May 1971, that some polytechnics have been eager to shed work which does not suit the image of an institution poised for university status. While it took many of these institutions until 1992 to finally become universities, the process has indeed been for some time. And as we know today, the university sector accounts for most of design education in the UK. And while some institutions continue to call themselves art schools, they are for the most part department schools or faculties of art contained within larger organisations. There is little doubt that the creation of a uniform system of higher education qualifications and the inclusion of art design disciplines within British universities has done much to rectify the perception of art education as a second-class option in comparison to academic study. Some may complain that the arts have been forced to comply with inappropriate institutional expectations and demands, but this is equally the case for all subject areas outside the favoured STEM regime that drives contemporary government education policy. Yet, there is something about the term art school, especially in the UK, that exceeds its merely denotative function, and which certainly does not refer to the free market, target-driven, employability index, transferable skills, student satisfaction chasing, enterprise zone of the 21st century university. Art school and its derivative, the art student, are descriptors that acquired their dominant characteristics during the post-war years, where the 150-plus art schools soaked up a considerable proportion of the massive youth demographic, neither qualified for nor desirous of Britain's still highly exclusive university education. By the 1960s, art student fulfilled more or less the same semantic function as, say, beatnik. And art school was less a description of an educational establishment, and it was a signifier for an entire sub-project. Art school meant progressive, permissive, and experimental in good or bad ways, depending on your politics, and possibly radical and certainly bohemian. While these are cliches, they serve to generate a widely shared sense, one that continues to animate numerous BBC cultural history programmes, that the distinctiveness of the art school experience was a decisive factor in post-war British cultural life, responsible for fueling the growth of the international reputation of the British design, advertising, fashion, and music industries, to name just four. The institutions themselves may have already been earmarked for amalgamation and closure, but the idea of art school became, and to an extent remains, I think, the preferred narrative formation for ever framing the antinomian energies of British youth as an innovative spawn of a state-funded creative educational environment. Perhaps people still think that the art schools are out there somewhere, though in all likelihood they have probably not thought about at all. Certainly the popular narrative never says much about what happened to them, and even the academic literature on the subject, as I'm not going to suggest, rarely ventures much further than the 1970s. Art school, like Harold Wilson's White Ink Technology or Enoch Powell's Rivers of Blood, is shorthand for a history that seems to stop with the oil crisis. It's true true that the high watermark of the Arsenal's influence was the 1960s and 70s, and it's also true that, like the other cultural formations of that era, the legacy of Arsenal was part of the British cultural imaginary cast a long shadow. Matthew and I started Arsenal in the early 1980s, at the tail end of things. But when the idea of a purpose-built art school in a small town bereft of any other significant post-compulsory education institution populated by academic underachievers on maintenance grants was still, to all intents and purposes, normal. We had absorbed, I think, the flavour of two decades of art school mythology, and often, despite evidence to the contrary, imagined art school as a portal through which a less mundane future might be imagined and accessed. The extent to which those post-adolescent imaginings are true or not is not really our concern here, but what has come to seem important is a broader disjunction between myth and history, between the persistent spectral fantasy of a thing called art school and the dismantling of the structures that allowed that fantasy to take on embodied form in the buildings, practices, habits and values of institutions capable of sustaining creative communities in often unexpected places. While the myth of art school is still with us, the material legacy of those institutions has largely been forgotten. Many art school buildings have been repurposed, redeveloped, abandoned, or demolished. The history of art education in the UK favours the famous London schools. In, for example, the Tate's recent legally funded project, Art School Educated, which promises an investigation, it says, of curriculum development and institutional change in UK art schools 1960 to 2000. It is in fact dedicated to exploring decisive reforms in the curriculum of the major London art schools and how the curricula that were adopted relate to the output of the artists whose work is represented in Tate's collection. Another recent project by photographer and painter Paul Winstanley, called Art School, takes a broader approach. Winstanley photographs unpopulated studio spaces in what he calls 50 art colleges. Yet what he's after is a set of images of empty, interchangeable, white walled spaces that serve as abstracted blank screens upon which can be projected imaginary scenes of art school activity, whatever that might be. The blurb for Winstanley's art school book explains that the sterile nature of the spaces depicted is, quote, juxtaposed by their intended purpose of fostering intense creativity for a future generation of artists. These photographs are intended to highlight the importance of British art schools, he says, at a time when the art school system's existence is more flawed than ever. This description indicates the limitations, I think, of Winstanley's project. These are, in the vast majority of cases, not art schools at all, university art departments. They're not part of an art school system, but a relatively minor part of a higher education infrastructure that dismantled and absorbed art education into itself decades ago. The blankness and interchangeability of the images not only conceals the erasure of art schools as actual places, but also embraces the context within which actual students might do things that contradict the pristine whiteness of the vacuum that Stanley depicts. Tate and the Winstanley projects indicate some of the problems faced, I think, in approaching the subject of art schools in the UK. The tendency to focus on London, on successful artists, on art, on an art school system, such preoccupations serve to reproduce the fiction of art school in a relatively unchallenged way. Art schools, these projects suggest, are maybe the places from which artists emerge. The Tate project reverse engineers art schools to produce Tate artists. Winstanley imagines a dehistoricized space from which will spring, after a period of intense creativity, a future generation of artists. Now, Matthew and I are interested in art schools, and we're also interested in the idea of art school. We're less interested in art, artists, myths of intense creativity, or the good old days. We're interested in history, but not heritage. We're interested in legacies, but not revivals. We're not the Billingsbury Preservation Society. But just as a belief in healthcare funded by general taxation should not mark us as fantasists longing for the Soviet Socialist Republic of Great Britain, nor should a commitment to education of all sorts, including our education, funded by general taxation, mean that we are out of touch, dreamers, nostalgic for a world that is long gone. In asking then what was our school, we are not interested in promoting the myth, but in asking where it came from, what made it so potent, and what work it might be made to do. Now Matthew and I became interested in our school for fairly prosaic reasons, among which is the fact that the context within which we first went to our school now seems almost unthinkable. Great Yarmouth College of Art and Design. Off the beaten track, produced no great artists that we know of, served no flourishing creative constituency, and yet every year a new cohort of modestly qualified, oddly dressed young people with their grants undertook a range of courses in this Norfolk outpost, mainly graphic design, fashion, textiles, foundation course. And as a consequence, provided an out-of-season seaside resort with rent and custom. Unlike much bigger institutions, our schools, like Yarmouth, generated a tight, some might say narrow, sense of collective identity determined by its difference from its immediate surroundings. It's hard to imagine anywhere else within a 30-mile radius where you might be exposed to, say, recent developments in art theory or even the history of 20th century painting. To say that one might become a convert to the project of the artistic avant-garde or to the work ethic of the commercial design world, for that matter, while ensconced in studios situated in an economically blighted corner of Eastern England, is not to glamorise the situation, but it now seems remarkable that such a place could ever have existed. Where are the 150 articles like the one going on there? And what happened to them? Why does it matter? It mattered to us more once we discovered that it was not easy to find out where they were and what happened to them. So beginning in Great Yarmouth, Matthew and I spent the last 7 years or so locating, researching, photographing the art schools of Great Britain. We're nowhere near finished. Primary aim is to answer some basic empirical questions. Where were they? Do they survive? What is there now? And these simple questions, not exactly profound research questions, but nevertheless have led us beyond the simple inventory of sites to think about broader questions about the state of British towns, cities, politics of urban planning, the role and status of the arts in local communities and in national discourse, continuing challenges faced by art education specifically, the university sector generally. In short, what began as a survey of old art school sites quickly demanded a wider consideration of social and economic history, geography, politics, cultural education and policy. Not only did the lack of decent record of these institutions that we've been told so many times were so productive in British cultural life, challenged us to start to create one, but contemporary debates surrounding gentrification, cultural industries, privatisation of public space, student fees, precarious labour, also began to press hard the story we started to tell. The article really began to become provocation. What Matthew's going to do now is kind of show you, talk through some of the sites that have been visited.
Thanks, John. Can you hear me okay?
Great.
I'm one of those academic underachievers. I never studied at the university, so my whole trajectory was through the art school system. So it began, and John's academic career at Great Yarmouth. And I had occasion to visit Great Yarmouth in 2007, 2008, and I was aware that the former art school had closed, but I hadn't really taken it all back to my mind. So it was curious to visit somewhere like that. My first formal interview when I was 17. And it was in a sorry state. As you can see, it's actually affected parts of Temple College. It's great enough, it was a purpose-built hospital. It was designed purpose-built for the study of art design in Great Yarmouth. But the thing that really shook me, and I found really bizarre, was that it was for sale. The institution that I studied at was actually for sale for the price of a two-bedroom flat in London. So, to some extent, it felt like, you know, I've got a certain amount of time and I've got a number of friends who've got qualifications from this institution, which, what does that mean? They've just disappeared. And as John said, this for me sparked a really key question. Was, at that time, was this just, you know, a fluke, break off, out of the disappeared? Or was it something bigger? Was it part of a pattern of change in our education that I haven't really taken a board since I moved into working within the university sector. Shortly after that visit, I started a new job at the University of Brighton. That's a curious coincidence. The office I was given, I don't think it'd been cleared out or any paperwork taken out for about 30 years. It's just this sort of amazing, what could have been archive somewhere, you know, student complaints and all sorts of stuff. And there was this little map of the UK, the numbers of it, and all these numbers related to art schools. And that was the kind of clue, really, or some sort of a little bit of evidence that we had these schools certainly had existed. And crucially, they had their addresses on. So, I mean, at this time, this project really, for me, was a very side project, something I'd do at the weekend, something I'd do when I wasn't working on other projects. But, and then things were, you know, these were physics out. So this was one of the first projects I visited, which was Bilston School of Art in West Midlands. And it's in probably one of the worst state in Great Yarmouth. It wasn't even the same, it was just basically abandoned. And we aren't going through this today. Obviously, there's a number of histories around this building, who built it, when it was built, how it was funded, etc. But I think the more important thing is to get a sense of an overview, really, which is what we want to try and do. So this is, this was Chelmsford, Essex Technical College School of Art. Again, not in particularly state repair. That's now been converted into a hotel. This is the Moseley School of Art in West Berlin, which is like a number of these buildings, great to miss it, so it's not going to be demolished anytime soon, hopefully. But this has got really bizarre histories here. This was a art school for people of 13 who go to the school. It was for very, very young people. There was a number of these art schools which students of, you know, of school age, 10, go through to the age of 16 and then they go to a large art school. But when it finally set the requirements, it was actually taken over by Ugandan refugees who turned it into, they still own it in some kind of cultural centre. This is what it was again, keeps saying these was. Dover School of Art by Wickham, which is now a dental practice. So one of the things that's that is it's not that you can't study art and design by Wickham anymore. You can, but you would go to the new Bucks University to study art design. So what's happened is that the kind of history or the original buildings that were used have become, you know, they're not seen as appropriate, they're not big enough, or their status in the town is maybe such that they're more valuable to sell off for some other use. And I think that really alters the perception in the town of the place of the art school, because as I say, as John says, it's a curious thing that the art schools were not on the margins or out the window, they were right in the middle of the town. One of the reasons they were in the middle of the town is no one had a car, so that's what you literally walk through, it could be like the library, the post office, the inventors, the art school. And so, potentially, you could look for their work at Temple College. So the very presence there, I think, is important. And that's obviously not what it is now. Formerly College of Art, now converted into, as the case of a number of these buildings, now converted into flats. Now, one of the things that started to become very interesting was, well, are there any pictures of art schools as they were? There isn't a book from Ruby Foy. There's several books on the wall which are unknown. So I started to look at, stumbled across some postcards. And weirdly, postcards have been a really good source for us, images of former art schools. Because in many towns, that was something you would have got. It's like they build it. Put it on a postcard. And this is the postcard for Stroud School, which is actually still there. I think it's a building. It's now being used as a private sixth form college. This is the building that Sunderland School of Arts in. Now, this is like a number of these buildings. This was not actually purpose built as an art school. This was actually gifted. It was actually a private residence, which was gifted to the people of Sunderland to be used in perpetuity as an art school. Joe and I both went to this building on the day that it was being cleared out. The University of Sunderland had sold it. And so we had a rarer view of the interior of these buildings, a bit of an echo of the old Roman Stanley project here, perhaps. Except that these were no longer to be used as spaces for fostering intense creative ideas, but literally I think it was going to be sold and used as commercial property. So this was all going pretty well in terms of there was these art schools I could visit, photograph, document. And then I came to Horsham to see the art school. And Horsham Art School, another one that it had been, listed, greatly listed, and there was a little sign there to say that it had been there. But if you looked over the fence, it had gone. So that was Horsham School of Art. And what had happened was that the building had been seen to be surplus to requirements and sold to as a great city building to a property developer, but then very mysteriously a fire happened. And then it decided that the building was completely very dangerous, very unsafe, and it had to be demolished. And now, actually, I haven't said that now, that is actually the site of about 12 houses. But with the power of eBay, I was able to buy a postcard of the old Horsham School of Art, just see it on its original site. So what we decided was that if the art school isn't there, we will photograph what is there. And this is another site of a former art school, Wordsley School of Art, it's now Bridge of the West Midlands. And one little clue to that here is you see the railing. That would be to stop people running out straight into the main road from the gates of the art school. Since its demolition, that site's obviously just been left empty. But on other occasions, this was the site of Brighton College of Art, which is now a series of executive homes. But I take on a website, there was a really lovely quote from a former student who said, although it produced no household names, Brighton College of Art was the starting point for many professional artists' careers. Humble, but noble, by my thought. This was Sidcup School of Art. Sidcup was a really, what might happen in art school in the 60s, kids which first of all studied there, and it was a purpose-built building from the 30s. But again, through various mergers and acquisitions, it ended up being part of Ravensbourne, what is now Ravensbourne College of Art, Ravensbourne University, and subsequently fell into disrepair and was demolished. Postcard of Handley School of Art, which I came across in Stoke-on-Trent. Amazingly, really amazingly, Stoke-on-Trent used to have six art schools. The reason it had six art schools was because of the pottery industry. But that art school was gone, it's now part of art. this was the final days of the West Sussex School of Art and Craft in Worthing, which was Art Deco building, which was then again, thanks to the requirements, demolished. And it is now, on the site, this is a sister digging flats. And there's a sort of weirdness feeling of how she's on the streets and perhaps studied there, maybe other people. Quite a few professors working on the sister digging flats. So I'll now move on to John for the second section.
Thanks for the talk. So you get a kind of sense there of the kind of fates that have befallen many of the 150 art schools that were there 50 years ago. During the period that art schools were being amalgamated and closed, the notion of creativity, its awkward tendencies have been drained out of the educational system. It's increasingly repurposed as the core aspect of the generation enterprise. One of the sort of unexpected outcomes of our travels to find art school buildings was a sense that in a lot of towns there were springing up big new signature art galleries, cultural institutions of one kind or another. And it seems, you know, glaringly obvious that there was an interesting dialogue going on between the abandoned art school and what we came to call the culture shed of Blair's Britain. And there is, I think, a kind of an interesting and revealing narrative about the relationship between ideas of art and creativity and the whole kind of regeneration discourse, enterprise culture that we have had to live through. Indeed, our students were among the key players in the early days of urban redevelopment. Hippies and artists wrote a joke for David Lee in 1996, were the stormtroopers of the new middle class. I never saw myself like that way myself, but I suppose I was black. Moving into rundown neighborhoods and renovating them. And David Lee anticipated what would become the core of Richard Florida's notorious argument about so-called creative class during the 2000s, that it was the dynamic and entrepreneurial lifestyle of artistic types, tech workers, lesbians, gay men, that would provide the economic and cultural power to revitalize cities, especially if helped along with investment in signature buildings like high-profile art galleries and upscale shopping areas. Creative class argument became orthodox cultural thinking during the Tony Blair years, when talk of the nighttime economy, you may remember this back in the day, cultural quarters and the promise of an urban renaissance was everywhere. And to give you a flavour of the rhetoric here, I have a quotation here from John Montgomery, the urban planner, managing director of Urban Cultures Limited, and advisor to the UK government at the time. And this is what he said in 2003. Just close your eyes and drift back. Most great cities have identifiable quarters to which artists and cultural entrepreneurs are attracted, whether it's Soho in London, New York's Lower East Side, or the Left Bank in Paris. Such places have a long history and appear to have happened by accident, or at least in the general development city over time. What is new about the development of cultural quarters in more recent times is that they have been and are being used as a deliberate model for urban regeneration of declining inner urban areas. In other words, they have been adopted as policy mechanisms for urban regeneration. And to sort of say that I don't think there's supposed to be any irony in that, Montgomery admits that these famous bohemians developed by accident, but he fails to mention that they acquired their reputations because they were considered undesirable by everyone else. Soho, of course, was the centre of the sex industry for 200 years. The Lower East Side was a traditionally working class, ethnically diverse immigrant neighbourhood. Montparnasse drew artists because of the cheap rent. People lived there because they could not afford to live anywhere else, nor were they welcome. The whole point of bohemias is that they are under the radar and home to marginalised populations who often have very little choice where they live. How much of an accident it was that Soho, the Lower East Side, and the left bank emerged in the forms in which they did probably depends on how familiar you are with Foucault. What really causes the eyeballs to roll, though, is the notion of an engineered bohemia as a policy mechanism. This might work in San Francisco, but what about Teesside, where the Middlesbrough Institute of Modern Art opened in 2007 at a cost of £14.2 million? Or Colchester, that kind of city by the bay, where the first site gallery situated in the town's cultural quarter opened in 2011, costing £25 million. We will probably never see the like again, thanks to the global economic crisis that kneecapped redevelopment plans and the seemingly endless austerity measures that ensure perpetual paucity of affordable housing, stable employment, and adequate public services. The only gentrification that works now is that which is so revanchist that it completely appropriates a neighbourhood for the super rich. What's this got to do with old Arsenal buildings? Well, for one thing, the reputation of the creative industries in the UK is built on the work done by people who were originally trained in our schools. So that what we have in the late 1990s and 2000s it's politicians promoting a creative Britain agenda, even as the institutions that produce the industries for which the UK has become famous have been removed. Furthermore, the material sites of art schools have, in many cases, been literally repurposed to fulfil regeneration objectives. In some cases, as we've seen, remodelled into the ubiquitous luxury flats, often because they have big windows, high ceilings, and centrally located. As you see in the pictures. And far less often, as in great art, the social housing, which we'll come to. I suppose the most notorious example of this is St Martin's College in London, where the private residential agency selling what used to be St Martin's College as luxury flats used photographs of the artists who studied there to sell the penthouse apartments. So, what has article building got to do with cultural regeneration? I think quite a lot. Many of the towns and cities that built expensive new galleries and museums during the 2000s as a centrepiece of cultural quarters for the creative class also had articles close by that were no longer in use. The local article milieu may not be as glamorous as the left bank, but it did produce a bohemia of sorts. Young creative types who congregated in neighbourhoods and adapted them to provide for their needs through cafes, shops, and services. These were no more accidental developments than the bohemians of Soho and the Lower East Side, but they did differ in significant ways from Montgomery's model of urban regeneration. The cultural quarter model geared to consumption and spectatorship. The article was about production and participation. Cultural quarter is a temporary stop-off point, touring exhibitions, curators, visitors. The article is anchored in the daily business of learning and making. Put simply, the article helped to move people outward and into art. The gallery and the cultural quarter moves art in and through. Seeing the international art in a local gallery is exposure to art of a particular kind, but it's untouchable, spectatorial, leisure-oriented. And with these thoughts in mind, we kind of put together a small book which placed side by side some art school buildings and some not art school buildings. Matthew, do you want
to? Yeah, I'll elaborate a little bit more evidence perhaps what John's been talking about. Yes, this is becoming maybe a little bit familiar with. This was the Walls Hospital of Art, which actually now sued offices to let. And in making these visits, it seemed that not only, it seemed West, not to be something like just photograph what, you know, what remains of the art school, but to maybe have a look around, see what else was there. I mean, the more obviously, the high street. Which if you walk down, you end up coming to this really impressive art gallery, the Westminster art gallery. And that cost 21 million. And one of the things that you need to think about, and surprise the arts council person to think about it more, is that if you build a building for 21 million, it means it's going to cost quite a lot of money to run it. You're going to have to have staff, you know, maintenance costs, you know, things that go wrong need to be up renewed. And there was in the, or certainly the local press in West Midlands recently, Warsaw School Art Gallery was in danger of being closed. And it's now, curiously, formed a link with the University of Northampton. It's actually become some association. So there's some movement there when we first produced our book on the possible culture share. And as John said, one of the reasons for these, building these galleries, was that it was going to reach out to places like Warsaw. There would be organisations like the Splash, who would build luxury flats. And there are some luxury flats in Warsaw, as we pointed out, part of the plan that went ahead. But it did seem odd that there was, you know, this juxtaposition between the place where people might go to study art, and the place where you could look at art, being very, very highly invested in and promoting. And if it had just been one case of this, perhaps it wouldn't have, certainly wouldn't have made very much into an art, but as we looked around, there were more and more examples. This is the building that used to house Dart School Art, and nearby, the marketplace, is the quad. I'm not a fan of that building. It's I don't think it works on any point inside the room. This is the former Thanet School of Art and Crafts in Margate, Kent. Amazing 1930s building. And one of the more successful, actually, I'd say, being celebrated. New galleries is the Turner Contemporary, which is in Margate. That was designed by a prize-winning architect, David Chipfield. One of the things that's curious here, I think, is that most of the art schools that we've been looking at were built and designed by local architects, people who lived in the town, worked in the local planning office, and used local materials, local skills. And it, to some extent, reflect maybe the architecture in that town. All of the culture sheds were built, especially examples like Margate and the one in Colchester, John Fuchs, who first started, built by superstar architects who would fly in, or whatever, when you get to Margate. And, you know, put them in the iconic building, it would be open. And they do look, you know, sometimes it works, but they do look alien. They do look like they've just landed. And one of the things that, this is a bit of, seen that actually coming out of Margate, Dreamland. At the opening of the Turner Contemporary, Tracy Edmonds, famously, is from Margate. She was interviewed and they said, what do you think Margate would be like in 10 years' time as a result of this massive investment and exciting art gallery? And she said that she would be an artist. That's what it does. She thought that it would not just be about art regeneration, but it would actually be an artist. And you know what? She was right. Because there is an art school there in Margate. It's called Open School East. And it's a sort of non-profit making. It receives 90,000 a year arts council funding, £90,000. Bear in mind, the gallery won 25 million. And it is an interesting project. In fact, I think it's a very, very interesting project. And I think it causes us, we might want to reflect on what we could have done with some of that money in other times. But I must go on to what I think is a truly extraordinary decisions. This is West Point School of Art, which again, service requirements, designed built by the architect. It's a very elegant entrance, and seems free, it's sort of high aspirations of the local people. 5 minutes from the corner, the public, 72 million pounds. 72 million pound art gallery. Designed by Will Russell. Spectacular. And it truly is like a spaceship. Now, West Bromwich doesn't have a railway station or swimming pool. This is the interior of the public, where it was. That's like when I sort of went and said, and the running costs of this building are 1.6
This is another phenomenon to point out, is that the art school, the technical school, and local library are often contained in one building. It might be in the local museum as well. This is the High Library Art School Technical School. And whilst the technical school and art school are close by some time ago, they're now closed the library. There's a whole building is now closed. And at the back, you can actually still see some of the studios. Harris Institute, Preston. I mean, what a magnificent way of doing that. That was a gift to the university. Now, I thought that the fact that Yarmouth had been sold was a really bizarre phenomenon. Right, well, that's how much it is. What about that? Now, there are some plans. This is the formerly Walker School of Art. It's got another nice trace of what formerly Walker Art School. It's now flats again. All right.
All in my heart.
Which is very awesome. Berlin. Municipal School of Art in Berlin.
Basically, it is a service requirement to make an enormous difference.
Stockport College of Art. Oh, Stockport College and School of Art. And what's one of the things that this is that you can't actually see the front of the building, because that building is in the city of the higher rise in front of the building. Curiously, this was with former members of Tennessee study. They went on to form Strawberry Studios, which both New Spark and the services. Warrington School of Art. Warrington. And again, I was curious, this fortunately, when you were the caretaker. That's very well. And he said, "Oh, you never look inside then." I said, "Well, that would be great."
You're not going to see those words.
Okay, here we go. Finally, it's for science. Oh my God, can you believe it? Another one. And I'll just go to the final slide. She's quite young. Beautiful.
Thank you. very much for your paper. It was really, really fantastic. I loved it. It had a predominant tone of elegy and some anger in it as well. But I wondered if you could say, is this a historical project for you, or does it have a future orientation as well?
Well, we're not historians. But I suppose my view for one is that more a provocation than anything else. First thing you do when you sort of say something, you criticise something, is that people say, well, what are you going to do about it? my view is that sometimes things are just wrong. I'm not a town planner or an economist or an entrepreneur, but the evidence seems to suggest that something seriously is amiss. So if it's future-oriented, it's an unexpected future. What are we supposed to do with this? What are we supposed to learn from this? For me, it's a kind of provocation. It's building to be a provocation to us. And the talks, hopefully, are something of a provocation, rather than a kind of prelude to some kind of utopian sort of solution that we've got in our back pockets. So if you've got any ideas, we'll go for it.
I think, for me, I'm interested in many pictures as an artist, but I'm also interested in having reasons to make pictures. And so this project is a focus on giving you a reason to make work in a way that I can work with very, very close to my life. I'm not working in a studio, I'm working outside. And so for me, it's primarily as an art project, which tailors very opens up a number of conversations and reflections on them, and I think it's about that. I think it's about now, it's obviously things we've had in the world, another thing that we've been doing. I take some interesting seeing what's happening with return to art schools. I think that could be interesting to explore further. But I think the no, they just made stuff up. They just extraordinary So that is a really exciting thing, is that there is, because by from this accident that the cities are asking, not building cities, asking, they just sort of emerge out of the post-industrial situation. So that's that, their original purpose of being lost or in life. But there was a moment that's gone now, it's very, very much gone, where they were left with this, and they put it out on the roads. That's an extraordinary thing to have education.
Thank you. trade,